Dystocia is one of the most common obstetrical condition in dairy animals, and if it is not managed timely, then becomes life-threatening to the dam as well as fetus, and thus causing huge economic losses to the farmers. This video covers handling of dystocia in dairy animals, which include preparation of obstetrical lubricants, then epidural anesthesia, then use of common obstetrical instruments, then fetal malpostures and their corrections, and fetotomy operations. Preparation of obstetrical lubricants. Lubrication of genital passage is necessary for easy manipulations of the fetus inside the uterus. Quantity of lubricant to be infused intrauterine that varies from case to case and depends upon the duration of case, the amount of fetal fluid lost during the process. Usually 5 to 6 liters of lubricant is sufficient per case. A good lubricant should be non-irritant, should have antiseptic properties, and have good shelf life. Carboxymethyl cellulose gel. This salt is easily available in India from different chemical companies and is widely used in the industry. However, it can be used as intrauterine fluid replacer. It is dissolved in lukewarm water at the rate 20 gram per liter. So for 5 liter of gel, 100 gram powder is required. Depending upon the total volume, a measured amount of CMC powder is sprinkled over the lukewarm water. Then it can be mixed properly with hand mixer. If hand mixer is not available, then the beads of the CMC can be rubbed between the palm multiple times so that it can be properly mixed in the water, and a stringy translucent gel is prepared, which is similar to the natural lubricant, that is amniotic fluid. A small pinch of potassium permanganate crystals is added to this to provide antiseptic property, and then again mix it properly. Finally, it will have light pink color and stringy consistency. Preparation of linseed tea. Linseed is commonly known as alsi. We can take 50 grams of linseed seeds per liter, and these seeds are mixed in hot boiled water and crushed with hand mixer. If hand mixer is not available, then previously crushed seeds are mixed in water and then boiled. The solution thus prepared is sieved using tea strainer. Then following this, a small pinch of potassium permanganate crystals is added to this to provide antiseptic properties. And then again mix it properly. Finally, it will have light pink color and stringy consistency.
Caudal epidural anesthesia. Epidural anesthesia causes desensitization of tail and perineum region. It is useful when straining is to be checked during handling of bovine dystocia and in cases of prolapse of rectum and genitalia. It is also useful during episiotomy and other surgical interventions on perineum region. The epidural anesthesia does not affect the uterine contractions during third stage of labor and during involution of uterus, hence is best suited for obstetrical operations. For epidural anesthesia, we need local anesthetic drug, razor, needle, disposable syringe, cotton, gloves, antiseptic solution, and alcohol or spirit. Lignocaine hydrochloride 2% solution is the most commonly used drug for epidural anesthesia with an average dose of 6 to 10 ml, that is between 0.22 and 0.5 mg per kg body weight. Its effect lasts for about 90 minutes. Technique: the injection is given in epidural space, which is between vertebral canal and spinal cord. In large animals, the most common sites for epidural administration are first coccygeal intervertebral space, that is C1 and C2, then sacrococcygeal intervertebral space, that is S5 and C1. So first of all, restrain the animal properly in a standing position. Then locate the site of injection by moving the thumb downward from the sacrum while moving the tail upwards and downwards in a pump-like manner. The first proximal moving space that can be easily palpated is the preferred location, as sacrum consists of 5 fused vertebrae, so it is easy to confirm the movable sacrococcygeal space. But sometimes sacrococcygeal vertebrae, that is S5 and C1, are fused too, especially in older animals. So in that case, next movable space is preferred for epidural anesthesia. Then the site in the dorsal midline is clipped and aseptically prepared using a disinfectant solution. An 18 gauge needle about 1.5 inches long is used to penetrate the intervertebral space. So take 18 gauge needle and insert it in the middle of space at right angle to normal contour of tail head or top line of animal. You can make an angle of 10 to 15 degree cranially or caudally as per your convenience to enter the space. Then pass the needle downwards for a distance of about 2 to 4 centimeter until it strikes the floor of epidural space. If there is no resistance to needle and to the flow of drug, the needle tip is supposed to be in the epidural space. Then withdraw the needle slightly to inject the required amount of drug. Before injection, negative pressure is applied by syringe to ensure that blood or spinal fluid is not aspirated. Otherwise, needle must be withdrawn and adjusted slightly, and negative pressure is applied again. Correct placement of needle can also be checked by hanging drop technique, which can be performed by placing few drops of saline or anesthetic into the needle hub during insertion. Gently inject the drug and then withdraw the needle. Then apply a spirit or alcohol swab to prevent any contamination afterwards.
Use of common obstetrical instruments. First one is obstetrical snare or obstetrical chains. The chains are used to apply traction on the fetal parts. We must take precautions. First is the passage, birth canal, is well lubricated before taking the chains in the uterus. It is to be applied above the joint preferably above the dew clause. There should not be any fetal membranes in between the snare and the fetal part. The loop of chain is held in between the thumb and the little finger and is fixed above the dew clause so that it cannot get slipped down from its place while applying traction. Alternatively, one more loop of chain is applied below the fetlock to provide stability to the joint so that it should not be dislocated or broken at the time of applying moderate to severe traction. If chains are not available, then cotton rope can be used in a similar pattern as that of chains. Calf snare. Calf snare is generally applied over the fetal head for corrections and for mild to moderate traction. The size of loop of the calf snare can be easily increased or decreased as per the need. The loop of calf snare is placed behind the ears around the head, and the sliding lock is fixed between the upper and lower jaws so that strangulation can be avoided if the fetus is live. Once it is properly fixed, then apply chain handle on the other end and apply mild to moderate traction to pull the fetal head out. If calf snare is not available, the obstetrical chain can also be used in similar pattern that of calf snare. The loop of chain can be placed around the head behind the ears and the loop is fixed between lower and upper jaws. The other end of chain is fixed with chain handle and then traction can be applied. Alternatively, a loop of cotton rope with sliding knot can also be placed around the head behind the ears and the loop is then fixed between lower and upper jaws and then traction can be applied. Eye hooks. Sharp eye hooks can be used in dead fetus, whereas blunt eye hooks are used in live fetuses preferably. The hook is attached to nylon or cotton rope. Then the hook is applied on the inner eye canthus of the fetus. It should be properly fixed to avoid its sudden slipping and accidental damage to the genital tract. Once it is fixed, it should be covered with palm so that sudden slipping can be avoided. Preferably, eye hooks should be used only for correction of malpostures and not for severe traction on the fetal head. Obermeyer's anal hook. This anal hook is preferably applied on anal orifice when the fetus is in posterior presentation. The hook is applied on the inner eye canthus of the fetus. It can also be applied on lower jaw, preferably in dead fetus. It can be fixed in lower jaw where the depression beneath the tongue is felt. After proper fixing, a mild or moderate traction is applied to pull the fetal head. While applying traction, it should be covered with hand to avoid its sudden slipping and also to avoid piercing out from the jaw so as to prevent the birth canal from lacerations and tear. Graves-Schottler hook. This hook is used to apply traction when no fetal extremity is available or if there is no traction point available to pull the fetus out. After fixing it with a snare, it has to be applied on the bony portion of the fetal body. Dystochia due to abnormal fetal postures and their corrections. In large animals, fetus mostly presented in longitudinal presentation, and it can be anterior longitudinal when the anterior part of the body, that is head and forelimbs, is presented towards the birth canal, or it can be presented as posterior longitudinal presentation when posterior part, specifically hindquarter and limbs, hind limbs, is presented towards the birth canal. Normal presentation of fetus is anterior longitudinal presentation. Normal position of the fetus is dorsosacral position, where dorsum of the fetus is facing towards the sacrum of the dam. And normal posture, when both the forelimbs extended in birth canal with head resting on knee joints. Any deviation in these presentation, position and posture lead to dystochia. Common malpostures in anterior presentation: crossing of both forelimbs above the head. In this case, head is in the birth canal while the two limbs are felt short and raised up. Careful examination reveals exact fetal posture where both the limbs are felt above the head. For its correction, hold the displaced fetlock and hoof, which is considered best part of limb to correct or manipulate. Raise it, force it outward and downward to its appropriate side and extend it in the genital passage. Similarly, for the other limb, raise it up, rotate outward and extend it in a birth canal. Confirm the fetal position, posture before delivery of the fetus by applying traction. There may be crossing of only one forelimb above the head. For its correction, hold the fetlock and hoof, raise it, force it outward and downward to its appropriate side and extend it in the genital passage. Crossing of the limbs beneath the head. Pervaginal examination reveals the presence of head in the passage with one fetlock raised above the level of other. Careful vaginal exploration confirms the diagnosis. Grasp one limb from fetlock, slowly raise it up and displace from the other limb to extend it into passage. Delivery can be achieved with mild traction. Incomplete extension of forelimbs. It may be unilateral or bilateral. Pervaginal examination reveals that the nose and feet are presented together, or in some cases the nose may be more advanced than the feet. For correction, the limbs can be gripped from hooves and fully extended one by one by using hand alone or obstetrical chains or snares. Carpal flexion. Pervaginal examination reveals that the head is in the birth canal. One or both the forelimbs are flexed at the level of carpal joint and knees lie near the pelvic brim. Shoulder are bulging out and fail to pass through the pelvis. After repelling the fetus anteriorly, pass your corresponding hand in the vagina along the displaced limb. Grasp the metacarpal bone on the outside just above the fetlock joint. If possible, the other hand is used to grasp carpal joint. The two forces work together in the opposite direction. The limb is then raised upward and knee is turned outward. The foot covered with hand is extended in the genital tract. One or both forelimb completely retained. Shoulder flexion posture. Pervaginal examination reveals that the fetal head is presented either at the pelvic inlet or within the pelvis. There may be unilateral or bilateral shoulder flexion. In unilateral shoulder flexion, one limb is retained while other limb is extended. In bilateral shoulder flexion, that is complete retention, deeper examination would be necessary to diagnose the malposture where only head is presented in the birth canal. Only hand can be used to pull up, and efforts should be done to convert shoulder flexion into carpal flexion posture. Further, correction is done as indicated for carpal flexion posture. Lateral deviation of head. Paravaginal examination reveals that both the forelimbs are presented in birth canal with head turned back either to the left or to the right of the chest of the fetus. Generally, the tip of ear is palpable. Introduce the hand corresponding to the side of the displaced head into the genital passage and then grasp the lower mandible. Pressure is exerted on the fetal head, which is brought into the genital passage by its lateral rotation. The fully extended head and neck can now be delivered by applying traction on the extremities. Downward deviation of head. It can be of three types depending upon its degree. The first degree is vertex posture. The bridge of nose rests on the anterior border of the pubis and the forehead is directed into the pelvic inlet. For its correction, the hand is passed in the birth canal along the side of the face. The lower jaw or the nostril are grasped and the head is raised up and the neck extended into passage. Second degree of downward deviation is nape or pole posture. The head further drops ventrally, so much so that pole region of head is palpable at the level of pelvic brim. For its correction, hand is passed beneath the fetal head and then the lower jaw or the nostrils are grasped and the head is raised up and neck extended into the passage. Third degree of downward deviation is true head breast posture, that is extreme downward deviation of head. The head further drops down so that the ventrally flexed neck comes to lie between the two forelimbs at the level of pelvic brim and the head is placed adjacent to the sternum of the fetus near the thorax. For its correction, the hand is passed beneath the fetal head with more efforts and then the lower jaw is grasped and the head is raised while with other hand fetal forehead is slightly repelled so as to bring the lower jaw in birth canal and the neck is then extended into the passage. Upward and backward deviation of head. Paravaginal examination reveals that the head is turned upward and backward on the back of the fetus. At the pelvic inlet, the base of the neck or windpipe of the fetus can be palpable. Both the forelimbs are extended in birth canal. For its correction, after repelling the fetus, the fetal ears can be gripped and try to drop the fetal head on either side of the fetal body. Once it is dropped, correct it as a lateral deviation of head. Dog sitting posture. Paravaginal examination reveals the presence of all the five extremities in the birth canal or pelvic inlet. It means that both the forelimbs and both the hind limbs along with the head is presented in birth canal. For its correction, foremost important point is to identify the forelimb and hind limb. For identification of forelimb, the movement of fetlock and carpal joint is observed. Both the joints will move in same direction, whereas in case of hind limb, the fetlock and hock joint will move in opposite directions. The joint movement of forelimbs and the hind limbs will be helpful to identify the type of limb. Once identified, repel the hind limbs as much as possible and try to extend forelimbs in the birth canal. Common malpostures in posterior presentation: incomplete extension of hind limbs. In this condition, the soles of hind feet are directed upward. The tail and buttocks are palpable. Deeper examination reveals the flexed hocks and stifles pressing against the pelvic brim. The croup is raised and pressed against the lumbar region of the dam. For its correction, hold the hoof with one hand while press the hock with other hand and simultaneously apply traction on the limb. Similar action can be done for correction of other hind limb. Alternatively, after proper lubrication, repel the croup anteriorly into the uterus and simultaneously apply traction on the hind limbs to extend them into the genital tract. Hock flexion. On exploration of genital tract, the point of hock is palpable. The buttocks are placed just above the hocks and tail is palpable. This malposture is considered to be serious because the hock and fetlock joints of the hind limbs are flexed in the opposite direction, which can cause hindrance in the correction of malposture. After repelling the fetus, pass the hand along the canine bone and grasp the foot. Repel the hock upward and forward with the hand and simultaneously apply traction, and the foot is then pulled. Finally, extend the limb in the genital passage. Repeat the procedure if the condition is bilateral. Breech presentation or hip flexion posture. Pervaginal examination reveals that the perineal parts of the fetus are jammed in the pelvic inlet. The buttocks, anus and tails are easily palpable. The hind legs are flexed forward under the belly of the fetus. The space is very tight and the hocks are generally beyond reach. This is one of the difficult malposture to handle under field conditions. The hand corresponding to the displaced limb is introduced and the tibia is grasped from the lateral side near to the hock. Gradual traction on this part will lead to flexion of hock and stifle joint and will bring the hind limb into hock flexion. This conversion of hip flexion to hock flexion will help to correct the posture. This can now be corrected according to the procedure shown for hock flexion posture. Repeat the procedure for the other limb if it is bilateral. Fetotomy in large animals. Fetotomy is defined as dismemberment, dissection, or cutting the fetal parts inside the uterus to reduce its size and to achieve pervaginal delivery of the fetus. Indications for fetotomy. Fetotomy is indicated when mutations fails or are not possible to correct malpostures. Incomplete dilatation of the cervix, but sufficient to allow hands and instrument inside. Then if there is emphysematid fetus, if there is fetal monstrosities, and if there is fetopelvic disproportion. Prerequisites for fetotomy. Fetus should be dead. Epidural anesthesia and ample lubrication is required. Well-designed phototome and other instruments and technical knowledge. Phototome can be of two types, Thygesen's phototome and Utrecht or Holland type phototome. Thygesen's phototome can be detached in two halves and easy to sterilize in boiling water bath. At the time of its use, both the parts can be attached to make a single unit. The phototome head is having space for making wires or loop, and these openings are well fabricated so that wire saw should not break during sawing process. The other end of the phototome is having handle to hold the phototome at proper place to avoid its shaking during sawing process. The phototome is placed on the table. The threader is passed through one of the barrel of the phototome from the side of the handle. One end of the wire saw, approximately 10 feet long, is introduced in the eye of the threader, which is withdrawn back. The procedure is repeated on the other side of the barrel. This creates a loop towards the head of the phototome and free ends of wire towards the handle side. The wire in the wire saw handle should be properly fixed to avoid it slipping during phototomy operation. Ensure the size of loop of wire depending upon the part to be amputated. Cuts for complete phototomy in anterior longitudinal presentation. The first cut is amputation of head. For this cut, position of loop of wire saw is caudal to the ears around the neck, whereas position of the head of the phototome should be at posterior border of mandible. The part to be amputated should also be properly fixed with the help of chain, which can be further attached to the phototome itself. To reduce the excessive movements of the phototome while sawing, the chain can be firmly grasped by the person who is standing opposite to the main operator. Initially, start with short and rapid sawing movements. This will facilitate securing the wire saw in the skin. Later, the sawing movements should be long and forceful. Amputating the head at proper site will lead to nil or minimum bony projections in order to reduce the chances of lacerations or tears to the birth canal. Second cut is amputation of one forelimb. The position of loop of wire saw is between point of elbow and the chest, whereas position of head of phototome should be dorsocaudal to the cartilaginous part of scapula. An ideal cut will not be having any bony projection or sharp edges of the bone. Third cut is amputation of other forelimb. It is similar to the previous cut. Position of head of the phototome should be dorsocaudal to the cartilaginous part of scapula, whereas position of loop of wire saw is between point of elbow and the chest. Fourth cut is transverse division of fetal trunk at anterior portion of chest. The phototome head is capped at the point of scapular attachment, whereas wire saw loop should be around the thorax at the level of middle of the sternum. Fifth cut is transverse division of fetal trunk at posterior portion of chest at the lumbar region. the phytotome is capped posterior to last rib, whereas wires or loop should be at right angle to the phytotome head around the abdomen. Following amputation of abdominal cavity, evisceration process can be done to reduce the size of the fetus. Sixth cut is longitudinal division of the hind quarter, that is pelvic bisection. Prior to give this cut, the hind part should be properly fixed with the help of crazed Schottler hook, which is attached to obstetrical chain. In the partially loaded phytotome, the wire saw is attached to the instrument called leader or curving rope carrier, CRC. This CRC is taken in between the hind limbs and dropped there. Later on, this CRC is pulled out from under the fetus. The wire saw loop should be between the base of tail and tuberischii or pin bone, whereas phytotome head should be just cranial to the tubercoxerum of one limb. Cuts for complete phytotomy in posterior longitudinal presentation. The first cut is amputation of one hind limb. For this cut, the position of head of the phytotome is kept near the trochanter major, whereas position of loop of wire saw will be between tuberischium or pin bone and the base of the tail. Second cut, amputation of other hind limb. Similarly, the position of head of the phytotome will be near the trochanter major, whereas position of loop of wire saw will be between tuberischium and base of the tail. Third cut is transverse division of fetal trunk, specifically at lumbar region. For this cut, position of head of the phytotome will be just caudal to the last fetal rib, whereas the position of loop of wire saw will be at the right angle to the phytotome head around the fetal abdomen. It is perpendicular to the phytotome head around the fetal abdomen. Fourth cut is transverse division of fetal trunk at scapular region. For this cut, position of head of the phytotome will be posterior to the cartilaginous part of scapula, whereas position of loop of the wire saw will be at the right angle to the phytotome head around the fetal chest. Fifth cut is diagonal longitudinal division of the fore part. For this cut, phytotome is partially loaded and the wire saw is attached to small eye of CRC or leader. This CRC is then taken beyond the level of thoracic cavity just near the neck and it is dropped there. From the other side or from beneath the fetal body, it is pulled out and the other barrel of the phytotome is loaded again. Finally, phytotome head will be posterior to the scapular attachment, whereas the position of loop of wire saw will be neck and forelimb on one side and medial to opposite limb. Sixth cut, amputation of forelimb. The position of loop of wire saw will be between elbow joint and the chest. The position of head of the fetotomb will be the space between the scapula and thorax.
To watch more educational videos on veterinary and animal sciences, subscribe the channel and please touch the bell icon. Guru Angad Dev Veterinary and Animal Sciences University, Ludhiana on YouTube.